إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله إقرارا به وتوحيدا وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من بين خلقه وخليله أرسله الله بالهدى والدين الحق فأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى توفاه اليقين فصلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد عباد الله أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله فإن من اتقى الله وقاه ثم أما بعد أذكر لكم إخوتي وأخواتي في الإسلام موقفا حصل لي خلال هذا الأسبوع وهو حينما دعيت إلى افتتاح البرلمان الاسكتلندي عند كاثيدرائية سان جايلز في وسط المدينة ومقابل البلدية لأدنبرا والموقف ذكرني بموقف تاريخي مر على أمتنا الإسلامية منذ 1430 سنة وعلى ما يقارب ذلك فبينما أنا داخل في الكنيسة والبوابة أرادت أن تجلسني وراء الملأ لكن لما كانت هذه السنة أول مرة دعوا جميع رؤساء الأديان ورؤساء الجمعيات الدينية وغير الدينية كان المفروض أن يقدموني في الجلسة فسبحان الله أنا داخل رجل لعلي أجنبي عليهم من غير جلدتهم ومن غير ألسنتهم لكن كان الحق وهم فعلا سووا هذا قدموني في الجلسة فأنا جالس وأنا أفكر في الموضوع وفي المنظر أنا مررت على جميع الناس رجل إفريقي وأمامي الأسرة الملكية أقابلهم وعلى ميمنتهم وعلى ميسرتهم المنتخبين للبرلمان فالساسة والرؤساء ثم يليهم الأساقفة والبطارقة التابعة للملكة وها أنا ذاك ودعيت لأدعو ولأقرأ على مسامعهم آيات من كتاب الله ففي ذلك الموقف تذكرت ذلك الموقف التاريخي الذي مر على أمتنا ألا وهو حينما هاجر المسلمون الهجرة الأولى إلى بلاد الحبشة ولما عز على قريش وجود بلاد آمنة للمسلمين أرسلوا إليهم رجلين منهم عمرو بن العاص قبل إسلامه وعمارة بن الوليد بن المغيرة ليدعو النجاشي وبطارقته أي يردوا المسلمين إلى بلادهم أي إلى مكة فسبحان الله تذكرت الموقف ها أنا أقف وأقوم ومن ورائي لساقفة والبطارقة وهم على لباسهم قد تزينوا للموقف وللمنظر، وها أنا أقوم وأقرأ على مسامهم آيات من كتاب الله. وقلت لهم والله، لأن في عادة أنا لا أجهز الخطاب، أنا أخاطب على ما يخطر على بالي. فقلت لهم والله في هذا الموقف أنا أتذكر فقط أساسين اللذين عليهما أن أقوم في هذا الموقف هذا. الأساس الأول الإنسانية، ولذلك تلوت على مسامهم الآية الذي ذكر الله سبحانه وتعالى الإنسانية، فقال يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم. فسبحان الله، لأنني لم أتقدم عليهم لا في الجلسة ولا في الخطاب، لأنني مثلا من سادتهم ولا من رؤسائهم، لكن فقط لأنني إمام للمسلمين فقط. والأساس الثاني معاشر المؤمنين، قلت لهم هو أساس العدل الذي عليه يقوم السماوات والأرض، والله سبحانه وتعالى قال ولا يجرمنكم شنآن قوم على ألا تعدلوا، اعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى. وعلي ذلك قال العلماء أن الله سبحانه وتعالى لينصر الدولة العادلة ولو كانت هذه الدولة غير مسلمة، كما أن الله سبحانه وتعالى لا ينصر الدولة الظالمة ولو كان مسلمة، لأن العدل عليه قامت السماوات والأراضين، وهو أساس الثاني الذي أنا قمت في ذلك الموقف. وذكرني الموقف الذي قام فيه المسلمون يدافعون عن دينهم حينما أراد القرش أن يردوهم وأن يستأصلوا خضراءهم، لكن أبى عليهم النجاشي. لماذا؟ لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حينما وصف لهم هذا الملك قال إن فيها، أي بأرض الحبشة، ملك لا يظلم أحد عنده، فكان بالعدل. ولذلك لم يرد المسلمين بمجرد أن يستفزه قريش، بل قال ماذا جئتم به؟ فقام عليه جعفر بن أبي طالب وبين لهم مبادئ الإسلام، كيف أن هذا النبي جاء وهم كانوا عباد الأصنام وكانوا يأتون الفواحش والمنكرات، فجاء النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بهذا الدين الحنيف. فلما سمع هذا وتلألأ عليه نور الحق فقال والله هذا والذي جاء به موسى لا يخرج من مشكات واحدة، اذهبوا فأنتم سيوم بأرضي، والسيوم أي آمنون بلسان الحبشة. ورد قريش خائبين ذليلين وأبى عليهم أن يردهم. هذا هو الموقف، موقف العدل. ولذلك عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه لما سأل أحد أصحابه لعله ابن أبي أبزة ألا من استخلفت أهل الوادي أي مكة، فقال استخلفت لهم رجلا من الموالي، فقال أو استخلفت على أهل الوادي مولا على العرب، فقال إنه قارئ لكتاب الله وعالم بالفرائض. فذكر ابن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله لا يرفع بهذا الكتاب أقواما ويضع به آخرين. فهذا هو مبدأ الإسلام معاشر المؤمنين، الدين الوحيد في وجه هذه البسيطة وفي وجه هذه الأرض الذي جاء وجعل الناس على مستوى واحد وقرر المبدأ العدل الذي فيه من بطأ به أمله لم يسر به نسبه. فهؤلاء الموالي بفضل من الله سبحانه وتعالى وبحسب ما تقربوا إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى بأن كانوا علماء بدينه، فالله سبحانه رفعهم. وها أنا في ذلك الموقف نظرت والتفت يمنة ويسرة، وإذا أنا مقابل موجة من الوجوه البيض، ولا أرى فيهم وجوه من السود أو من غيرهم. وسأل لماذا لا؟ ولعل هذا الجواب يرجع إلى دينهم، لأن دينهم من أساسياته ومبادئه أن فيها طبقية وأن فيه طبقية، فالناس ليسوا أحرارا أن يرتقوا على المستويات. فلذلك الأسر ورؤوس القبائل والساسة وأصحاب الشرطة والعسكر لذلك يبقون على طبقة واحدة، والناس العاديين ليست لهم هذه الحرية أن يرتقوا في هذه المستويات. وهذا رفضه الإسلام من 1400 سنة وما يزيد. ولذلك أنا أنبه إخواني المسلمين، لابد أن نحتفظ بديننا، لأنه فعلا دين حق ودين عدل. وجاء الله سبحانه وتعالى ورفع من شأن بني آدم، حيث قال ولقد قربنا بني آدم، وقال ولقد كرمنا بني آدم وحملناهم في البر والبحر ورزقناهم من الطيبات وفضلناهم على كثير ممن خلقنا تفضيلا. فجاء الله سبحانه وتعالى بهذا الدين الحنيف. لذلك لا معاشر المسلمين، لابد أن نحتفظ بهذا الدين وأن نفتخر به، وندعو الناس إلى عدله وإلى إحسانه، وكيف أنه جاء لينشر العدل والأمن والسلام بين الناس. وإذا لابد أن ننتبه من أن يدب إلينا ما دب في أمم السابقة من الظلم والعدوان، ومن ما وصفوا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنها الجاهلية الجهلة والجاهلية الأولى، حينما يكون فيما بين الناس الأنصرية والطبقية والطائفية. فكلنا لآدم وآدم من تراب، وأقربنا إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى هو أقربنا تقوى، وأن الله سبحانه وتعالى لا ينظر إلى صوركم وأموالكم، إنما ينظر إلى قلوبنا وأعمالنا. قد قلت ما سمعتم، وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين، فاستغفروه وتوبوا إليه، إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله على إحسانه، وشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا الداعي إلى رضوانه. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I wanted to just share an experience that went by me this week. And I apologize if it seems to be a very personal-centric sermon, but that's because I recognize the great lesson that was in it, and I wanted to share it with you. For the first time in the history of what they call the kirking of the Scottish Parliament, the invitation was open to all of the faiths, i.e. the communities, the leaders were invited in order for them to recite that which their religious traditions had and to share in the ceremony, an act perhaps to show Scotland's integration and to show how it is a cohesive society. So therefore I was invited on behalf of the Muslim community, and I said at that moment, it reminded me of a very crucial time, or rather event, in the history of the Muslim nation. Because there I was, as I entered St. Giles Cathedral, and we had entered, obviously, after all the other people had come in and taken their seats. So we, the leaders of the faith communities, came, and there I was, outwardly an African man. So I was shown my seat at the back of the church. But however, it became apparent to them that no, I was a leader of a community, and behind me were the leaders of the other communities, the Jews, the Buddhists, the Hindus, the Sikhs, etc. So we were taken. There we were walking up the steeple until we reached our seats. I sat down, And whilst people were busy talking to each other or taking pictures, I just analyzed the situation. There was a man who's not really, let's say, from the ancestry of this country or from his royalty. But there I was seated facing the members of the royal family right ahead of me, with no barrier between me and them, me looking into their eyes. And on their right hand side, we had the members of the Scottish Parliament. And then adjacent to them, we had the members of the Queen's chaplains in their elegant red robes and their staffs and maces. And I looked at this. And as I was invited to go up to them and to stand on the table and to recite from the Quran, wallahi, I remembered this history, or this moment in the history of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the permission for the Muslims to go to Abyssinia, Ethiopia, Habasha, because he described to them there is in that land a king of justice. And so he therefore had the element of security that his nation and the followers of him who went and migrated to that nation shall not be wronged. So however, Quraysh, they were bitten by this. The fact that the Muslims had a safe haven with their religion. So they sent two emissaries, two people, to go to speak to Najashi, to allow him to return or to force them, or to deport them in our current day language, back to Mecca, so that they will continue to be oppressed, and so that they will remain under the oppressive regime of Quraysh. But however, as Najashi was described by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was somebody of justice. He asked them, okay, if these people you want me to expel them from my land, I want to know what they have. So he invited them to his court. And that was the very moment, dear brother and dear sisters in Islam, the moment that I recalled. Because in that moment when Ja'far bin Abi Talib, who was representing the Muslims, came to explain to Najashi and to his court that which Islam was, it is described that Najashi was in his court, in his palace. It was elegant, and he had his patriarchs, the bishops, and the fathers, and the ministers behind him in their elegant robes. Wallahi, that was the situation that I remembered. These people with their robes, all elegant, looking proud. It reminded me of this hadith with the historians of Islam like Ibn Asakir and Musa ibn Uqba and Ibn Ishaq and other than them narrated in their books. That there they were, the bishops of Najashi, opening their scriptures to measure that which the Muslims were going to say against their own scriptures. So I said to them, in this very moment, I can only recall with regards to my religion two foundations which have made me to stand before you. Because when I looked around me, I saw a sea of white faces. And there I was, an African man, standing, not by virtue of my ancestry, or of my royalty, or of my wealth or privilege, but rather because the Muslims have agreed and accepted that I be the Imam of their central mosque. Wallahi, regardless of where I came from, my race, my ethnicity, my language. So I thought that was the most powerful message I could give to them. That this is the religion that forgets all these lines of all these human scales of virtue, whether you be from a royal blood or lineage, or from a family of wealthy people, but rather it looks at you, where do you come from in regards to how close you are to Allah. And it reminded me of Umar ibn Khattab when he asked, who was the leader of Mecca, when one of his companions came to report to him in Usfan. So this man said to him, indeed, I have left in charge of Mecca a person who was an ex-slave governing the people of Mecca. So Umar ibn Khattab said, have you appointed an ex-slave to lead the Arabs and their nobles? So the man said, indeed, he's not just an ex-slave. He is a scholar of the Kitab of Allah. He's a scholar of the Book of Allah. And he is a scholar of fara'id, the laws of inheritance. So Umar ibn Khattab remembered the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Indeed, Allah elevates by this book. He raises the ranks of a people by it. And he will humiliate a people by this book. This is the Islam that I wanted to remind them of. So the two foundations that I had to share with them was the foundation of humanity that Islam came to establish. So therefore Allah told us in the Quran, O you mankind, we created you from a man and a woman, and from the two of them we created you into countless nations, in order for you that you may know each other, not that you may hate each other or look down on each other or humiliate each other, but rather it's for the sake of knowing our roots, knowing our culture, so may we may come to recognize the glory of Allah. And the second foundation that made me to stand in that very position was the foundation of justice. It was justice, because the only thing that made me stand up in that day was because of that justice. And for that reason I remember the justice of Al-Najashi, when he did not just repel the Muslims or deport them because of whatever scaremongering that had been tried, or no, whatever campaign or hate had been tried to split the ranks of his community, but rather it was by justice. And I wanted to remind them of that justice, because Allah said, indeed, even if you were to hate a people, do not allow that hatred and that enmity to cause you to deviate from justice, but rather be just to them, because justice is closer to piety. So this is it. So the three messages I have from our community with regards to this: if this is our religion, the religion when some 1,400 plus years ago it established an equal human society, a society that humanity to this day and age is trying to achieve, when we're trying to see the civil rights movements, when we're trying to see all these campaigns, Black Lives Matter, when we're trying to see these people coming with Islamophobia or hating or having this discrimination, Islam came some 1,400 plus years ago and established and honored the children of Adam. As Allah said, that indeed we have honored the children of Adam, and they have made them elevated amongst all of those that we have created. Whether you be a black person or a white person or an Asian person or an Arab, indeed Islam said that all of us belong to Adam, and Adam was from dust. So therefore my warning to us, let us not allow anything that has affected the previous nations from them allowing their own man-made constructions of power to come into us. Rather, we are all belonging to Adam. And the one who is closest to Allah and the most virtuous is the one who has more taqwa than us. The one who is closest to the kitab of Allah. The one who is more knowledgeable than us. So we do not allow any element of nationalism, that I am from this country or I am from that country, I am from this race or that race, to divide us. That's the first message. The second message, let us therefore brace ourselves. If this is a religion that came to change the culture of a people and to establish justice and to say, rather all of you were one, created from one person, from that person that his mate was created, and from the two of them we made countless nations, of course our religion is going to be looked at in threatening terms. Of course people who want things to be in a normal way, where certain groups have the privilege of power, of course they're going to be scared by us. Of course they're going to feel threatened. But what do? We realize the justice of our religion, and we realize the power of it. So therefore we appreciate it, and we brace ourselves that indeed people will scaremonger, just as the people of Quraysh had scaremongered against the Muslim who went to Habasha. Let us brace ourselves for that. But what was the response from the Muslims, from Ja'far ibn Abi Talib? Was it to crawl back into his shell out of fear? No, it was not. It was to come out from his shell and to clarify to them, in front of all of them, that this is our religion. It is this and that. It is based on justice. It is based on virtue. It is based on spreading peace and security and well-being. It is not a religion of what people are fabricating. That it is a religion that divides society. That it is a religion that causes fear in the people. No, we refuse this. This is the challenge to us, dear brothers and dear sisters in Islam. And the third message, the message that I give to the individuals, that you, dear brother, and you, dear sister, if Islam is a religion that came to honor you, and they came to establish and to abolish slavery, as Umar ibn Khattab said, "Mata stabbatumun nas wa waladatuhum ummahatuhum ahrara." When have you created slaves of people? When their mothers gave birth to them in freedom. Islam repudiates and rejects slavery in all of its forms, whether it be in its modern form, when people are kind of almost conditioning society. So therefore I challenge you, dear brother and dear sister in Islam, are you somebody who is accepting the narrative? Are you accepting what society is putting on you? That, oh, I belong to this society or to this class, I cannot improve myself, I cannot elevate myself. No, this is not what Islam came. Islam came to say, you and the person who is from the royal family, you are the same. In fact, you might even be better than him in front of Allah. because the closest of you to Allah is the one who has the most piety. This is our Islam. So therefore I challenge you, dear brother and dear sister in Islam, do not have an inferiority complex where you look down on yourself, when you look down on your achievement and you look down on your community, but rather this is a religion of glory. Because why? It goes back to the one who owns glory, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, dear brothers and dear sisters in Islam, Allah has commanded to send prayers and salutation by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللَّهُمَّ صَلِّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِ مُحَمَّدٍ كَمَا صَلَّيْتَ عَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَعَلَى آلِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ إِنَّكَ حَمِيدٌ مَجِيدٌ وَبَارِكْ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِ مُحَمَّدٍ كَمَا بَارَكْتَ عَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَعَلَى آلِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ إِنَّكَ حَمِيدٌ مَجِيدٌ وَارْضَ اللَّهُمَّ عَنِ الصَّحَابَةِ أَجْمَعِينَ أَبِي بَكْرٍ وَعُمَرَ وَعُثْمَانَ وَعَلِي وَأَنَّ مَعَهُمْ بِمَنِّكَ وَكَرَمِكَ يَا أَكْرَمَ الْأَكْرَمِينَ اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم آمنا في أوطاننا، واصلح أئمتنا وولاة أمورنا، اللهم من أرادنا وأراد الإسلام بسوء فأشغله بنفسه، واجعل الدائرة عليه، وأرنا فيهم عجائب قدرتك، يا قوي يا عزيز، ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا، وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين، ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. أقيموا الصلاة.